Hello, I'm Farah Larieux and welcome to Haiti Journal. Haiti Journal is a monthly public affairs program covering current issues facing the Haitian American community in the U.S. and abroad, produced in partnership between WPBT2 and the Haitian American Professionals Coalition. On August 28, several Haitians were smuggled onto the shores of Palm Beach. One of them, a 14-year-old girl, was found dead on the beach. Either in their motherland or here in the U.S., Haitians are victims of frauds in different aspects. To learn about this issue, we invited Jaime Raich, Deputy Chief of the Major Crimes Section for the United States Attorney's Office for the Southern District of Florida. Jaime, thank you for joining us.
Thank you. It's my pleasure.
And what happened in Palm Beach, it's not an isolated case.
No, it's not an isolated case at all. Here in South Florida, we, as a member of the law enforcement community here, we see incidents like this far too frequently, where you have Haitians trying to leave Haiti on a boat, sometimes trying to get to Puerto Rico or the U.S. Virgin Islands, and very often trying to come here to South Florida. It can often lead to tragic consequences. It's a dangerous, difficult voyage. And a lot of times we only find the bodies. People die during that attempt, and it's something that we hate to see. As an assistant U.S. attorney and a federal prosecutor, my job on behalf of the United States attorney here, Willie Ferrer, my job is to often prosecute the smugglers when there's alien smuggling involved. Sometimes there is alien smuggling. Sometimes there's no alien smuggler. There are just people leaving. Regardless of which scenario it is, when people perish at sea, it's a tragedy. It's heartbreaking. And one of the reasons why we go to such lengths to prosecute alien smugglers when there are smugglers involved is because smuggling is a dangerous, dangerous activity, and it could lead to people dying.
And in this case, one of the victims told to the investigators that the group had to jump off the vessel. They were smuggled in and swim to the shores. Do you think that might be smugglers behind this case, or just people trying to escape from poverty in Haiti?
I can't comment on any ongoing investigations or cases, of course.
Okay.
But I can talk about patterns and practices that we've seen in the past. The views that I'm going to express today are not the views of, they're mine alone, and they're not the views of the Department of Justice or any of its agencies. But we see that scenario a lot. We have seen it a lot, where someone is piloting a boat, and perhaps that boat has come from the Bahamas or perhaps from some other place. The Bahamas are only 45 miles away from South Florida by boat. And a lot of times we have seen cases where the smugglers will bring people over in the cover of night, get within a couple miles of land, sometimes as far as a couple miles out, and then order people out of the boat. The smugglers have already been paid to do this. So they're collecting their money regardless of what happens to the people inside the boat. Not everybody can swim. But if you're told to get out 2 miles offshore, what choice do you have? So people jump out, they do the best they can, and a lot of times they die. It's nighttime. There could be bad weather. There could be rough seas. There could be people who can't swim. And the results can be tragic. We find, when I say that we find bodies, I mean it actually. We find people. Now, smugglers, our experience from prosecuting alien smuggling cases suggests that the alien smugglers who are bringing people from Haiti or from Cuba or from somewhere else, right, they're not freedom fighters. They're smugglers. They treat the aliens on their boat badly. Case in point, they order them out and make them swim to shore. What they're really concerned about is getting paid, and they really don't care who they're bringing in. They'll bring in people who are charged and convicted of crimes here before. They'll bring in old people, young people. They'll bring in children with no life jacket and no parents on board. They really don't care. What they care about is making a profit. And that's one of the reasons why we work as hard as we do to combat alien smuggling here. It's because the treatment of the people, you know, of the Haitians or whomever they are trying to come here, is hard.
And we see that the media are more focused on those coming, trying to get into the United States illegally. Well, they show all these people, and they also report that they are in custody. But we don't talk too much about the smugglers, those who been paid to do so. The captain of the boat. But can you elaborate more on that? Are you going after these people? What are the consequences to these people? And are they just, you know, get arrested here and sent back to Haiti? And you know,
we try to prosecute the alien smugglers as aggressively as we can, largely because we view alien smuggling as a dangerous and illegal business, because they're treating these people like merchandise, like cargo. When we are able to make a case against an alien smuggler, we arrest them, we prosecute them, and we punish them. Alien smugglers can receive sentences anywhere from a couple years to up to 19 years. Recently, an alien smuggler was sentenced to 19 years in prison. He was someone who lived here, was a member of this community here in South Florida. And he would make frequent trips to the Bahamas. And he brought people in for profit. When law enforcement was able to catch him, of course, he had people on the boat. They were from all over the Caribbean. They had all paid to be there. And he had money shoved in pants pockets and elsewhere, you know, and elsewhere. Because, again, the profit is really what's driving this. And because he was bringing people in for profit, and because a pretty high concentration of the people on his boat were convicted felons and drug dealers and narco traffickers, he actually received a very substantial sentence of 19 years. That's probably the high end of what alien smugglers are receiving. But in cases where the Haitians or other migrants are being abused, in cases where we can prove that it's smuggling for profit, and likewise in cases where someone dies, most especially in cases where someone dies, the person doing the smuggling, if we can make the case, is probably going to receive a pretty severe sentence.
And now in the case if the person, he is from a Haitian citizen and then living in Haiti, mm-hmm.
If we interdict a boat at sea where the smuggler is a Haitian citizen, not someone living here in the United States, but we can prove that that person was bringing people here to the U.S. illegally, then what we'll do is we'll bring the Haitian citizen into the United States, prosecute them. If we're successful, that person will serve a term of imprisonment. Following that, they'll go to Chrome or some immigration detention center for removal proceedings and be removed or deported back to Haiti.
And do you have the Justice Department has a collaboration with the Justice Department in Haiti, where once these people are deported to Haiti, or they serve in prison in Haiti too? Do you have any information on that?
As far as I know, let me put it to you this way. I don't know of any efforts made by the Haitian government to then imprison people who have served a prison sentence here for smuggling. Yeah.
Okay. And we see that there's other type of fraud, not only smuggling, people trying to come here with fake passport. Mm-hmm. What are different other frauds mm-hmm. that Haitian can are victim?
Yeah, there are a few others that we see. Before we move on, I want to make one point, Farah, which is that sometimes we hear rumors in that people in Haiti or that Haitian Americans living here in the United States, that you know that Haitians hear that there's a wet foot, dry foot policy for Haitians. And when that happens, that encourages more people to get on boats, often overcrowded, and to try to make it to the United States. And as you know, there is no wet foot, dry foot policy for Haitians right now. And I hope that your viewers will hear that and spread the word to discourage people from taking very dangerous boat trips from Haiti to the United States. Now, in terms of the other, there are three other immigration frauds that we see pretty commonly affecting the Haitian community in South Florida. The first is people trying to use fraudulent documents to come to enter the United States. The second is people living here using fake green cards or trying to get citizenship through fraud. And the third, and every bit as important, is the victimization and defrauding of Haitians who are living here and who want and are trying to get legal immigration status.
And let's go to each of them, based on their specific issues. You mentioned a fraudulent document, mm-hmm. Which is passport, visas. Mm-hmm. Can you elaborate on that?
Sure. One common thing that we see is Haitians arriving at Miami International Airport with fraudulent documents. And that could be a fraudulent passport. It could be a U.S. visa that was obtained through fraud. Or it could be a visa that belongs to someone else that they put their photo on, put into their passport, and then try to use to come into the country. At the airport, Customs and Border Protection is looking for those people and finds them. And when they find them, in many instances, they refer them to us for criminal prosecution. And those people who tried to come in the U.S., into the U.S. using fraudulent documents, they are prosecuted. The consequences to somebody who does that can be pretty severe. It is a crime. It is a fraud. The consequences to someone are that they are convicted of a federal felony here in the United States. They serve a pretty short term of imprisonment. It can be as short as 2 weeks. But that doesn't mean to say that then there are no consequences for that person. After serving that term of imprisonment, they're then put in removal proceedings and often deported or removed directly back to Haiti. The problem that they now face, of course, is that even though they served only a couple weeks in prison, what happens now when they try to apply for a U.S. visa? What happens now if they come back to the United States and try to make an asylum claim? They're in the system now as someone who's already tried to commit a fraud, to use fraudulent documents. And that will make it harder for that person in the future to make an otherwise, to make an asylum claim or to obtain a lawful visa to come in to visit family members or to come into the U.S. for any reason. So that's why I say the consequences to those to people who try to commit that fraud are severe.
And about the fake green cards or fake citizenship, what about that? Is it they're major, right?
Yeah, they're more severe. This is a different situation. Those are for Haitians who are living here and they've obtained a green card through a fraud. Maybe they, used a fraudulent birth certificate to get it, or they lied on their application about themselves in some way, or they used someone else's documents and got a green card for themselves. The same thing can happen at the citizenship stage. We see cases of people here who lie to immigration officials when they become U.S. citizens. Well, what we're seeing pretty frequently these days is that if we don't catch people when they commit that fraud to obtain citizenship, we catch them when they come in to renew their green card or if they have a green card when they then later apply for citizenship, and we catch them when they make that application. And so even though someone's been living here successfully for years with a green card, they get caught later. And frankly, our systems checks are better now than they used to be. So they're catching more people now than we used to be able to do. And what we do in that in those cases is we prosecute those people. And we prosecute them for the fraud, for committing immigration fraud. And likewise, the consequences of that can be severe for people. The consequences can be, though they're the same, if you can be, not in every case, but you can be deported to Haiti. If someone then later tries to apply for a visa or apply for citizenship, even through marriage, or if someone later tries to apply for asylum, having this fraud in your background, in your file, is going to complicate anything that that person tries to do in the immigration system here.
And we also see that there's a false a use of false identification for those who living here, even for a food stamp.
Yeah, that's there are a whole host of frauds that we're seeing facing the Haitian community. Using someone else's identity to claim benefits, like food stamps or Social Security benefits or tax refund benefits, and where people wind up stealing someone else's identity and claiming benefits for that, now there's a victim. The victim is the person who was rightfully entitled to those benefits, whether they were tax refund or Social Security or food stamp benefits. And where there's a victim, of course, the criminal justice system now treats that case more seriously. And that is a crime that we see pretty frequently. And I hope people sort of are listening and realize that they can get caught doing that and the consequences can be severe.
And some people are also using notorious to do some documentation.
Right.
And you see that type of fraud too.
Right. Yeah, I'm glad you mentioned this, Farah. This is something that is simply rampant in South Florida, and it's probably rampant in any community where Haitians are living in anywhere in the United States. What we're talking about now is it's kind of flipping the tables a little bit. This is a situation where Haitians are here, and they're trying to lawfully apply for immigration, for status here. They're trying to get a green card. They're trying to get citizenship, and they're trying to do it lawfully. And what happens to them is they go to someone who they think can help them with their immigration case, and they're defrauded. By that I mean they think the person's helping them obtain real, legitimate immigration status here, and what happens instead is that they're victimized, and they wind up with nothing. And they really get hurt in that process. There are a number of different ways how they get hurt. One of them is that this is a really common example. Someone comes in, a Haitian, and she says, I want to apply for a green card in the United States. I need a green card. I need a driver license so I can get a job. So the person says, sure, and pretends as if he's going to help her. What happens instead, right, is what these people do, and it's basically they're crooks. What they do is they file a petition for asylum on behalf of this Haitian. But they don't tell the Haitian that they're doing that. Once they've filed for an asylum claim, this woman now is free to go and get a driver license. She thinks she's got it made, because she's now able to apply for a driver license, and now she can apply for jobs. What she doesn't know is that this person she thought was acting as her immigration attorney has defrauded her. He hasn't appeared at her asylum proceedings. She doesn't know that they're going on. She doesn't have a valid claim of asylum. She doesn't receive the mail from the immigration system because the crook has had it directed to him and not to her. And as a result, she winds up losing her asylum case that she didn't even know was going on. And she winds up with an order of removal or deportation against her. So now here she is. She might think she was helped because she has a driver license, but in fact, what happened was bad, right? She was defrauded and cheated, and she's now got a much harder fight in the immigration system.
And in this case, do they prosecute the cooks? Mm-hmm. Do you have a case like that?
We do have some cases like that. We don't have enough. We'd like to have more. When we talk about criminal prosecution in this area, we're looking for the most severe cases. We wouldn't prosecute every case of the type that I just described, because we could never, you know, we could throw all of our people at it, and we could never do that. But my boss, Willie Ferrer, the United States attorney, has, you know, realizes the importance of this issue with the Haitian community and other immigrant communities here in South Florida. And he is looking for the most severe cases for prosecution. Some examples of what they would be are, here are a few. We've seen cases where people threaten Haitians and other immigrants with deportation if they don't pay them. So in other words, they're extorting someone for money and saying, if you don't pay me, I'm going to deport you. I'm going to take you to Chrome and get you deported. That's a severe case where there's victimization, there's probably economic harm, and there's fraud. That's the kind of case that we're looking for. Other cases that we see or that we hear about are cases where someone pretends to be an immigration official, or someone pretends to have a friend who is an immigration official. And so these people tell the immigrant, you know, the Haitian, I have a friend, I can get you a green card. Why don't you pay me $10,000 and I'll get you a driver license, I'll get you a green card, you'll have it made. Time goes by, right? Nothing happens. But now the person's saying, well, you know what, it's going to be $15,000. Now you know what, it's going to be $20,000. And by the way, if you don't pay, you know you're here illegally, we're going to have you deported. You don't want that, right? And you can see how that's now a family that's being extorted. They're being defrauded. They're living in fear of family separation and possible deportation.
And to these people, how they can find justice or report the type of fraud?
Well, they should come talk to us. We realize that we're asking a lot there. Because
usually, you know, someone who is undocumented will be very afraid to go to the officials because they feel like, well, you know, there's consequences for me too.
That's exactly right. That's why I think we're asking a lot. But what we like is when the victims work through their immigration lawyers or their attorneys to contact us. They can even contact us anonymously. So an immigration lawyer can call and say, I have a person, make up a name and just say, and this is what happened to her. Would you handle this case?
And if they want to go to a family member, want to help them, or someone, usually we go, immigrants go turn to their priest, their pastor. Is it something that they can also do?
Absolutely.
And they can do it anonymously.
Absolutely. And they shouldn't. We hope that people will get the message and come forward to us. And, you know, we can't prosecute every case, and not every case is criminal in nature. But in the most severe cases, we hope that people will come forward and talk to us. If no one comes forward, these frauds and victimization are going to continue unabated, as they have been for a long time.
And last question, because we are out of time now, but what will happen to the smugglers that we who drop these people in Palm Beach?
Mm-hmm. You know, I can't talk about any specific cases. I wish that I could.
Mm-hmm.
But I can say this. When we find smugglers, we look under every rock, in every place we can to find evidence. We talk to all of the migrants to see if they'll try to help us to make a case against them. And if we are able to prove a case, and in fact we can show that people perished because of it, then hopefully we'll be able to bring charges.
Thank you, Jaime. And earlier at the beginning I mentioned that this young girl who died on the shores on the on Palm Beach by trying to get into the United States by boat. And this is a tragic, story. And we send our condolences to the family. And again, thank you, Jaime, for bringing this to the community. And we hope that people will learn and we'll be more careful.
It's my pleasure. Thank you very much.
And for more information about our program, please visit our website at wpbt2.org/Haiti Journal. We return next month with another edition of Haiti Journal on Sunday, October 13th and Sunday, October 27th at a new time of 12:30 p.m. right here on WPBT2. I'm Fa Laoye. Thanks for watching.